Hello friends, welcome to Geology Concepts. So in this video we'll see igneous petrology, and this is the basics part. We are starting igneous petrology from today, and we'll get deeper into it lecture by lecture. Okay, so let's get into it. Igneous petrology. Okay, the rocks which are formed from lava directly solidifies to form igneous rocks. Okay, we will see forms of igneous rock. Before that, we will see what are the factors on which igneous rock depends. So it depends on the mode of the formation, where it is forming, how it is forming, when it is forming, and the viscosity of magma. So if the magma is acidic, is very highly viscous, and if it is basic, it is very less viscous. Means basic lava can flow, acidic lava doesn't flow. Okay, that fast or that quickly. Okay, viscosity on the other hand also depends on the temperature and composition of the magma. So that again explains, okay, the acidic composition and the basic composition. Relation with other neighboring rocks. So the this also depends on what are the host rock or the country rock surrounding the igneous rock. So it will react according to it and take a form. Now the two main forms that we discuss are intrusive and extrusive rocks. Okay, so let's see intrusive rocks first. So intrusive rocks can be of two types. First, when they are formed at a great depth, they are called plutonic. When they are shallow or they are formed near the surface, then they are called hyperbasal rock. Then based on the relationship with the surrounding rocks, there can be two types of intrusive rock. First is discordant, which are cutting across the structures and not in line or not parallel to the structures. Other is concordant rock, which runs parallel to the structures, like the bedding plane has the same attitude as the country rocks. Okay, so in discordant rock, there are dikes in the unfolded region that cuts through the rock and appears out in crisscross fashion. It can be anything which is not following the general order of the attitude of the beds of the region. Then there are ring dikes, so they are forming in every direction, so they radiate out from the center. So these are ring dikes. Then there are cone sheets. They are in the shape of a cone, and on the top they appear circular. So this is also again not according to the not following the general concordant nature, not concordant with the surrounding rocks. Okay, that penetrates through it. Okay, then these are all in the unfolded region: dikes, ring dikes, and cone sheet. Then there are batholiths. Batholiths are massive igneous rocks, but they may present in the folded region, but they are massive in nature. Then there are ethmoliths, which are funnel shaped. Then there are harpoliths, they are sickle shaped. Okay, then there are conoliths, which are irregular intrusions. Okay, so all these are discordant type of rocks. In concordance, in the unfolded region, like in folded, in unfolded region there are beds. So what is sill? Sill is that it will run parallel to the bed and occupy a position here, okay, in a sheet like form. So in the sheet like form it will form, and those are called sills. Then there are locoliths. Locolith is something like this. This is the bed, and they form like this. Okay, this on the top, so it is convex up. Then there are lopolith. Lopoliths are convex down, or you can say concave up. So these are lopolith. This is lopolith. This is lacolith, and there is again a bismolith. Okay, so these are a type of rocks which are unfolded. Okay, then there are phacoliths. What are phacoliths? They are crescent shape. You know, crescent shape, something this shape is the crescent shape, occurring along the crest and the trough. So how they occur, let's see. So suppose this is a fold. Okay, this is a fold running through, and this lopolith will come and occur here in this portion or in this portion. Phacolith, sorry. So these crescentic shape they take according to the folds, This is called phacoliths. Okay, so this is the shape they will take. So these are discordant concordant rocks. Now moving on, we have extrusive bodies. So in extrusive bodies, the rock is formed when the lava comes to the surface. So mostly they are concordant. That can be explained from the lava flow diagram. Like this is, let's say, a volcanic peak. Okay, the volcano, from the volcano the lava comes out. Okay, so this lava is spread slowly over the surface, okay, and forms layer by layer. Okay, so this becomes concordant with the host rock. Okay, they follow the same attitude of the host rock. If there is a fold, it will flow alongside, so it will form a concordant mass. But they can also be discordant in a way. Let's say this was a fold, okay, the lava comes cutting through this, okay, so this is discordant because it is not following the general pattern, it is cutting through the rocks and coming out. Okay, so this is discordant. So then these two ways extrusive rocks can also be present. Next is, we say the structure of the igneous rock. A structure can be seen at three scales. Structures can be seen at three scales. So first is the large scale structures, then there is small scale, and there are micro scales. Okay, you can also call mega structures. Okay, then this is micro. So in large structure, there are vesicular and amygdaloidal. What this means is that when lava solidifies, some lava contains gases and volatile matter, so that volatile matter comes oozing out of the rocks and forming small cavities on the surface. Now these cavities are called vesiculars, and if they are filled with some kind of external fluid, they are called amygdaloidal. Okay, then if the cavities are much larger in shape, they form what is called a pumice type of rock, okay, which is perforated. Then there is block lava. What is block lava? We see, when the lava flow is difficult, that means it is acidic in nature. When this acidic is highly viscous, so the flow is restricted and the surface which is formed is very rough, which is also, we also call it as AA structures. You will read this in structural geology also when you will see the igneous structure. So AA structure. So this cannot flow. So this will not flow, then it will form blocks. It will not flow, it will form blocks with a rough texture. So this is called block lava. Okay. Then we have the ropey lava. Now ropey lava is when it is very low viscous, and which is basic lava, which doesn't contain that much amount of SiO2. Okay, higher the SiO2, more acidic the lava is. So less SiO2, basic lava will flow through large distances and will form a smooth surface. So the first slide that we saw in this, in the introduction slide, that was like a ropey lava. So it will flow to a long distances and form a very smooth surface. Okay, this is also called pahoho structures. Then there are pillow lava. Pillow lava are formed in the form of bulbs. These bulbs, when lava flows, it solidifies, it flows, it solidifies, it flows, it solidifies. This forms the pillow like structures. So this is called pillow lava. Then there is sheet lava, sheet structure, and this columnar structures last. So in small scale structures, when we see a small scale, if we go a scale deeper, there are primary foliations in the rock, then there are banding in rocks, alternate color bands or alternate mineralogy. So there can be bandings in the rocks. Then there are schillerin, which is wavy, streaky and irregular sheets. Okay, then if we go more deep, there is micro scale. What is that? There is reaction rims, when the rock reacts with the, so let's see if there is a rock and there is a country rock beside it. So at this junction point, there will be some reaction going on between the two, because this igneous rock is very hot. It reacts with the country rock and then form a reaction rims. The rims at which the, or you can say at the surface where the reaction takes place. So this can be seen on a very micro scale. Then these myrmecite structures, which is actually nothing but intergrowth of quads and plagioclase feldspar, plagioclases, and then graphic texture intergrowth between quartz and orthoclase feldspar. Xenolithic is that when there are rock fragments or foreign bodies which are not expected to be present in that kind of rock within igneous rock is called xenolithic structures. Okay, so these are the structures. Next is textures. Texture is important because questions come from this part directly. What is texture? Is a function of three things. First, it is the size. You know, texture is what you see. Okay, so it will depend on the size, then shape of the rocks and the relationship between the grains. Means we'll see it in just a minute. And extent of crystallization, how much amount of crystallization has happened. So which means that if it is completely crystalline, then it will cause holo crystalline. If it is partially crystalline, then it is hemicrystalline. If it is not crystalline at all, it is called holocrystalline. Okay, then we'll talk about size of the grain. Phanerate is the grain that you can see from your naked eye in a rock. So if there is a rock and there are small grains in it and you can see it, all the small grains you can see with your naked eyes, these are all called phanerate. Now these can also be of three parts. First, coarse. If it is formed at the depth, then it will get all the time it need to form, and then it will form a bigger crystal slowly, bigger crystal, more big crystal. So this is coarse in nature. Then there is medium sized. Then there are fine grained. If lava comes out of the surface and quickly it solidifies, it doesn't have the grains or the mineral doesn't get time to grow, then this is very fine in nature. Very fine. You can just see it. Okay, phanerate. This is the smallest grain which is visible with the naked eyes, or phanerate. Then there is aphanitic. Aphanitic means it is not visible with your naked eye. It is microcrystals. Okay, you can see it under microscope. And also there are glassy in nature, which has no crystal at all. It just solidified and without the formation of any crystal. Okay, so aphanitic is between micro and glassy. Okay, then we have shape. So if shape of the crystal discussed, then there can be euhedral or idiomorphic, subhedral. If the shape is very nicely formed of the crystal, it is called euhedral. If it is partially formed, hemihedral, and there is no shape at all, enhedral. Okay, and distribution, this could be development. So distribution, development of grains. What equidimensional grains? If all the grain is freely allowed to expand or develop in all the directions, it is equidimensional. Tabular, if there is only two direction, let's see, if the to explain tabular form, if there is a high pressure from the top, let's say there is a very huge rock and here the lava is crystallizing, so due to the pressure the lava will only grow in the plane which is perpendicular to this, means perpendicular to this direction, so in two directions only, x and y. So this will be tabular form. And if there is also pressure from, let's say, this side, then it will only grow in one direction, which is perpendicular to this plane. So this will have prismatic or one direction. Okay, this form needles like structure or elongated structures. Okay, so this is the distribution type. Then we have mutual relationship between crystals. What do you mean when you say mutual relationship? See, if they are equigranular and they have good shape, then they are pendiomorphic. If they are equigranular but not nicely formed crystal, then hypidiomorphic. Then, and if there is no shape at all but they are equigranular, they are allotromorphic. Okay. And if they are inequigranular, the size are unequal, are not equal, then there are porphyritic texture in that, where large crystal is enveloped around a ground mass. So this is porphyritic texture. Why? How it happens? Change in physicochemical conditions and molecular concentration and insolubility. Vitreomorphic, when ground mass is glassy, we call it vitreomorphic. Okay. So this is it. And next is poikilitic texture. Poikilitic, we have kind of discussed before, smaller crystal enclosed in larger one. Okay. Type of poikilitic, you say euhedral plagioclase surrounded by augite. Okay. Characteristic of dolerite rocks. This is basically ophitic texture you see in dolerite rocks. Then there is something called intergrowth. We have also seen in the when we discussed the structure and the microstructures. So graphic intergrowth was between orthoclase and quads. Parthetic, you have to just learn this one, all these three. Parthetic. Parthetic is albite and orthoclase. So between albite and orthoclase, then myrmecotic growth is between quads and feldspars. So remember myrmecotic. Okay, rest is dependent on orthoclase. Myrmecotic is important, quads and feldspar. Okay. Then there is granophyric, which is found in hyperbasal and volcanic rock. Okay, so this texture, so these three, four types of intergrowth you have to remember. All the questions will be from this. So this is confusing because you don't remember which one is orthoclase, which one is quad. So you have to keep revising it. So see, when you make notes, no, highlight the point that you need to keep revising, and once you are done once or twice with notes, the third time it will not take more than a minute to revise one topic. You just select these two topics or come back to the video, just read it or listen to it. You can download the video, convert it into MP3 and listen to it. Okay, so this will also help. So graphic texture is orthoclase and quads. Parthetic texture is albite and orthoclase. Myrmecotic texture is quads and feldspar. Okay, these three are more important. Okay, so this is for this video, and we'll now go deeper into Bowen reaction series, understanding magma, then differentiation and assimilation part. Okay, so till then, please like the video. Mention in comments, did you get the concepts? Did you understand? My voice is clear or not? I mean, you can mention any kind of problem. I'll try to fix it in the future videos. Okay, so till then, have fun and keep revising. See, revision is the most important part. Subjects where there's a lot of information, revision is important. If you keep revising, you do not have to bother about learning things. It will be at your tips. Okay, so till then, have fun. Bye for now.
Subscribe to know your planet better.